Extravaganza, number 2, Copenhagen, Denmark, 1976, featuring Napoleon Murphy Brown on tenor sax and lead vocals, Andre Lewis on keyboards, Terry Bozio on drums, Roy Estrada on bass, and yours truly, Dick Hug, Huggy Boy on guitar. Now, if I can get a little monitor in this box here, because that feedback was coming from Napoleon's box. Help me out, Dick. There it is. A little bit more, please. Thank you very much. And now, in the dark, where all the papers go, under the water, where the shark bubbles blow, in the morning, by your radio. Do the walls close in to suffocate you? You ain't got no friends, and all the others that hate you. This is the life you've been leading, you gotta go.
Yes!
Let me straighten you out. Out of place I know. I get your shoes and socks on, people, because it's right around the corner. Out in the night, the whisper of breezes to the place where they keep the imaginary diseases. Out in the night, the whisper of breezes to the place where they keep the imaginary diseases. Stupid disease, bromidrosis, and well, they should. But us regular folks, who might wear a tennis shoe or an occasional python, know this exquisite little inconvenience by the name of stink foot. That's right, that's right. You know, my python boot was too tight. Couldn't get it off last night. A week went by, and now it's July. Finally got that son of a bitch off, my girlfriend cried. You got stink foot. Stink foot, darling. Your stinking foot puts the hurt on my nose. Stink foot, I ain't lying. Could you rinse it off, do you suppose? Well, here, Fido, here, Fido. Bring the slippers, little puppy. I asked you to bring me the slippers.
Oh, Frank, I was so stoned I couldn't keep them in my mouth.
Well, Fido, look. Look, boy. Look here, boy. I asked you in a very nice sort of a way to bring me the slippers.
Yes, you did, Frank. You were so nice to me, and I really appreciate when somebody is very nice to me and asks me to bring
them. Yeah, I know, you stupid son of a bitch, but I asked you to bring them, and you didn't bring them.
Oh, well, you know, I'm
now look, Fido, I want to make one thing perfectly clear. You did not bring the slippers. I'm bigger than you, and you can be punished to the full extent of Danish law, just like they did to that guy who said, put the tape recorder on the telephone in case the Russians attack you. They got that son of a bitch in jail. Now look what's going to happen to you.
Oh, you mean you're going to hurt me?
Yes, I'm going to hurt you.
Oh, hurt me. Yes, I'll hurt you right now.
There you have it. When the poodle, or poodle as they say in the trade, when the poodle was first constructed, it was a very attractive dog. As a matter of fact, God really wanted it to be a schnauzer, but he fucked up. And this is what happened. Now, when the poodle was first constructed, it had hair evenly distributed all over its small, piquant, charming, canine-type body. Then, God made two big mistakes. The first one was called man, and the second one was called
Woo-Man.
Woo-Man looked at the man, and then Woo-Man looked at the poodle. And then Woo-Man looked at the man again. And she looked at the poodle again. And then she looked at the man again and said, "Hey, why don't you go out and get a job?" And the man got up and got a job. And he got a paycheck. And he brought the paycheck back to the Woo Man, which is exactly the way she had it figured out to begin with. And the Woo Man took the paycheck away from the man and went out and bought a pair of scissors and came back. And the reason she did this is because she wanted to fuck the dog. But she didn't want to fuck the dog with hair evenly distributed all over its small, piquant, charming, canine-type body. She wanted a mod dog. She wanted a very stylized dog. She wanted a dog that looked like an English person's hedge. So this is what she did. Just a swinging through the trees. She took the scissors and she removeth the hair from around the snout of the poodle, thereby exposing, although you can't see it very well in our blue and yellow replica, thereby exposing that sensitive area, the little black poodle lips that are so interesting with the little wart-like objects on them on the side. Now, she figured that later on, when things got really interesting, she could grab the poodle by its jowls and ram its charming little muzzle right into her thing there. Well, anyway, she got the scissors. You know how they do. You've seen the book too? That's right. Now, then she took the scissors and cleaned up on his medulla, because she always wanted a boyfriend with a flat top. And ever since she saw that group over there at Daddy's Dance Hall, she figured the next best thing, if she couldn't get them, was to get the poodle. You know what I mean? So she started cleaning up on the medulla of the poodle. Now, as if that weren't enough, she had to straighten this boy out in the thorax region, too. Also in the fetlock. The tummy. The managua. And right here, she cleaned up all of the tables at the Palace Hotel. Really cleaned them up good. And then she set the poodle up for a big thrill. Now watch this. She makes the poodle stick out its tongue. She says, "Tongue boy." And the poodle goes. And then she takes off her pants. Actually, it was a jumpsuit. Goes over and sits on the poodle's face. That's right, you heard right. And then she looked deep into the poodle's eyes and caressed it and said these words.
Thank you.
wind power. Now I see my tears in lonely misery. I know now you never really loved me. It hurts me now to think you never really did. You know you never really cared. I sit and ask myself a thousand times to try. You
wondering, why is it so hard to see my way? And why should I be stuck with you? Since not what I want to do. Why should any embrace to make me such a part of you? I got no more to give up.
Program, ladies and gentlemen, this is a very romantic song. We hope that each and every one of you in the audience tonight who is in love or has been in love recently or intends to be in love sometime within the next 24 hours, especially if it has something to do with any member of this rocking teenage combo, this song is dedicated to you. The name of this tune, and you probably won't believe this at first, but it'll grow on you. Oh, shut up. The name of this song is Black Napkins, and here it goes. Thank you. Was that a soul brother out there actually saying right on to me for those stupid fucking chords? You shouted out from that audience and you said to me, right on? Well, far fuck.
working out. Specific, and the answer to those questions lie ahead.
Thank you.
in, in his dungeon of despair. Prisoners grumble and piss their clothes and scratch their matted hair. A tiny light from a window hole 100 yards away is all they ever get to know about the regular life in the day.
And it stinks so bad, the stone's been choking.
Right on, Napoleon!
Peter Kid Bobby was a friend of mine. Open three of his eyes and the boots damn black. Open four of his eyes and the boots damn black. Open five of his eyes and the boots damn black. He opened six of his eyes and the boots damn black. Look like, you know, she might be a devil walking my room with a hot water bag. Might be a little horn by this. Might be a devil had a long dress down here. Might be a devil from eyes just looking over the sky. She said, I've been to Europe, got me some clothing.
Thank you.
time again, ladies and gentlemen. Time to tell you the tragic true story of Michael Kenyon, the Illinois
Enema Bandit.
Michael was a lonely sort of a person. He had a speech impediment. There was probably a little bit of a queer, too, on the side, but you never know about these people. Michael, for the last, and he was in the Army, too. Michael, for the last 10 years, has been committing a series of terrible crimes against the female inhabitants of the area right near Chicago. I'm sure that means a lot to you right here. But I can see that you're duly impressed by Chicago. You know the Windy City gangsters, rat-tat-tat-tat-tat. Just outside of Chicago, there's a place called Bloomington, Illinois. It's farm country. It's that lovely kind of country. It looks sort of like the outskirts of Copenhagen out there. It's sort of nice and pleasant, except that they have a university and a Howard Johnson's motel, and that's about it. They also have a bunch of college co-eds who live around there, and that was the target for Michael Kenyon, the Illinois Enema Bandit. He would go out at night wearing a ski mask, carrying a briefcase. In the briefcase was a gun, some rope, a thermometer, and an enema bag. Now, Michael would go into the back door. Well, go ahead, that's for sure. He wants it. Give it to him. Well, hey, John. Terry wants some. Smothers. Terry wants some. He wasn't doing it. He just said he wanted us to be sucked off during the show. All right, now. Michael would break in with his equipment, aim the gun at the girl, and say, "Take off your clothes and become naked, nude, and right on before my very eyes." And as if by magic, Michael would then proceed to tie them up. And then, sure you did. I know you did. Look at you. You would do that.
They all wanted me to.
I know they wanted you to do this because your mask is so cute. Then Michael would take out the thermometer and stuff it right up her poop shoes.
Sure he did, Terry. Yes, he really did.
And then he would wiggle it around a little bit and pull it out and read it to find out the correct internal temperature of the college-educated woman. And then he would go and put it away. Then, hey, now we're getting down to business. He would take the bag into the toilet and fill it up. I know this is in bad taste, but what the fuck, it's a true story. Now watch, you would take the nozzle and it would stick it into the rear end of the college-educated woman. Probably the most fun that she had since she got her diploma. Bring her here. This girl's name is Rhonda. Rhonda was a PE major. PE stands for physical education. Rhonda would have turned out to be a very, he just jams it right out of the poop shoot there. I'll tell you a little bit about Rhonda while we're giving her the treatment here. Rhonda was going to become a physical education instructor herself, but as you can see, she has very highly developed leg muscles. Rhonda is now working in the cafeteria at a high school just outside of Chicago. She'll never be the same. Rhonda's laying there going, "No, no, Michael, don't do it. No, no, no. Don't. Stop. Don't. Stop.
Don't stop. No. Don't stop. Don't stop. Oh, no, no, no. Don't stop. No, no. Don't stop. What kind of cologne are you wearing, Michael? Don't stop. All my men wear Russian leather. No, no. Don't stop.
English leather.
Oh, no. Don't stop. No, 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 no. No.
Well, I really hate this, Michael. Don't do it to me because it really hurts so much and the water is going up my doo-doo parts and everything. Oh, and no, why didn't they tell me about this in college? And I'm going to stand here and say this stuff for about another 15 minutes. Just Oh, yes, Billy. Wait, I think I'm going to... Yes! College-educated women do go to the toilet. Michael helps. Michael always helps. And then Michael beats his meat. And then Michael turned to the girl and said, in a very deep, clear voice,
"Don't call the police for at least 5 minutes because I'm armed and dangerous."
And then he disappeared. He was arrested, tried, and convicted in December of 1975. He is now in the penitentiary on 5 counts of armed robbery because Michael took money from the ugly ones. He should not have done that. He should have just been happy that... Those girls couldn't be any worse than that finished pornography book that we got. Has anybody here ever seen the advertisement for Miss Pinky?
No!
Right on then, and here's our song for Michael and Miss Pinky, wherever she is.
Thank you. Thank you.
ladies and gentlemen, good night.